It's a pleasure to be here. I am delighted to be invited. I thank Mr. Saeed Al-Bagawi. I thank Asma, did all the contacts and all the organization. Thanks so much. It's really a topic that is dear to my heart. I am an astronomer and physicist, astrophysicist, but I always define myself as an educator first and foremost. Because of my love for science and my long-time engagement with science in terms of teaching, in terms of research, public outreach, writing, lecturing, etc. In the last several years, I have become interested in what is the extent to which science has spread or disseminated its ideas and its knowledge in the culture of society, particularly in our part of the world, in the Arab Muslim world. So we'll get to that. I just want to warn you that there will be two tests in the middle of this presentation. I am serious. My students will attest that I always give tough quizzes, so just be warned. They always say he explains very well, but his exams are from Mars. So anyway, we'll see. There will be quizzes, okay, just so you know. But first things first. First of all, what do we mean by culture of science? And is it the same as science literacy? Let's dig a little bit. As you probably know, this is going to be the first in a series. So next week or next Monday will be the same as this in Arabic. The week after, the following Monday, not Tuesday, we will have a more in-depth look at this. So today is just sort of looking at the broad, what are we talking about, what do we know about this, what is it that we don't know, what should we try to know, things like that. And then if you want to know, okay, so what are the real concepts and what are the real issues and what are the challenges and the different models and the literature and the academics and what have they said and things like that, you need to come in 2 weeks. But today, at least, I hope you'll get a general understanding of this topic. So, what do we mean by culture of science is the same as science literacy? The short answer is no. The long answer will take half an hour, and we'll get through that. But there are a number of topics or titles or expressions like science, scientific, because sometimes it is called scientific literacy. I don't quite agree with scientific literacy, because literacy is not scientific or non-scientific. It is literacy about science, so I prefer to use science literacy. Very often it is referred to as public understanding of science. To what extent does the public understand science? Sometimes they use, not very often, but sometimes you find in the literature this public attitudes toward science. I think public attitudes toward science is more in the sense of culture of science, as I will define it and explain it later. Public appreciation of science, public engagement in science or with science, science and technology in society. Citizen science, which is quite different. Citizen science is when the citizens or the commoners, let's say, the general public starts to participate in the endeavors of science. They do experiments, they make observations, such as, for example, astronomy. We have advanced amateur astronomers, and they contribute some real data by taking some very good images or making some measurements. There are people who really participate in this sort of global endeavor. Sometimes there's a collective call for, can you please make this? And we call that citizen science. That's a whole topic in itself. And finally, there is culture of science. I'll try to clarify all these ideas as we go along. But essentially, it boils down to two types, science literacy and culture of science. Science literacy is how much do people know and understand about science, how science functions, etc. And culture of science is to what extent has science spread into our mode of thinking and behaving and policy making and media and general education and the books and so on and so forth. Culture of science. Definitions, there are a number of definitions given to science literacy now. So the first part of the talk, maybe two-thirds of the talk, will be devoted to science literacy. This is what is most known and studied, and there is some data. I will explain how much data do we have on science literacy, and how much data we are lacking, and what we can do in that regard. And in the last third or so, I will talk about culture of science, and I will explain that there is very little study and understanding of the culture of science, which is the more relevant, in my view, more relevant. John Miller is somebody who has specialized in this. He's the director of a Center for Public Understanding of Science, University of Michigan, etc., has given this definition. It is the civic scientific literacy represents the level of reading and comprehension skills needed to read the science section of the New York Times, or to watch an episode of Nova. Nova is a long-running series of science documentaries on PBS in the US, on public television. So according to him is, how much do you need to know if when you read the New York Times science section or you watch these science documentaries, you can really follow what's being said. Another definition given by the National Science Education Standards in the US is that science, again, they refer to it as scientific literacy, which is not my preferred expression, means that a person can ask, find, or determine answers to questions derived from curiosity about everyday experiences. It means that the person has the ability to describe, explain, and predict natural phenomena. So you see that now we have gone a big step forward. It's not just how much do you know so you can understand what I'm talking about. It is your ability to really explain and describe and even predict some natural phenomena. You are really thinking as a scientist. You have this ability according to that definition. Another more recent definition, you may have noticed that the previous definition of the same National Science Education Standards was from 1996. The more recent one is that it is the knowledge and understanding of scientific concepts and processes required for personal decision making, participation in civic and cultural affairs, and economic productivity. So again, there is some kind of an active involvement here. How much do you need to know to be able to think and participate in such processes? From a recent paper, or somewhat recent paper, another definition, it is recognizing and analyzing the use of methods of inquiry that lead to scientific knowledge and the ability to organize, analyze, and interpret quantitative data and scientific information. In other words, this is saying it is how much you understand in order to figure out that this is a scientific endeavor. This work is really scientific, this work is not scientific. If you can distinguish between the two, then you have scientific literacy or science literacy. If you can distinguish what is a scientific piece of work and what is not a scientific reasoning or piece of work. So that's another definition. Now, why is this important? Why is science literacy important at all? Because science and technology are playing critical roles in our lives. First of all, in health. There have been all kinds of debates regarding vaccines. People misunderstand or misuse antibiotics. We have a huge antibiotics problem because people have misused antibiotics so much. We have developed these antibiotics resistant bacteria, and now it's big problem. Contraceptives, how they work, and are they halal, not halal, in different, especially in our part of the world. About food, diets, do they work, don't they work, how do they work, you know, carb diets and whatever diets, and vegetarian, non-vegetarian. Organic, additives, vitamins, protein supplements, high calorie, high caffeine drinks. Now we have all of this, and people just, you know, keep kicking around all these ideas without any proper scientific background. So that's another area where science literacy is important. The environment, pollution. I think it was 2 weeks ago I published an article in Arab News in Saudi Arabia, and it is online everywhere, and one of the pieces of information is in the Gulf, the amount of pollution, roughly, if we talk about CO2 or particle pollution, etc., is 4 times the international level, just so we know, even in this part of the world. And it is 8 times the rest of the Arab world. So if we know what it is, and we know why this is, and how we should behave about it, then this kind of science literacy becomes not only important, it becomes vital. So this is just to give you an idea: pollution, water management, carbon footprint, and the economy, innovations, new products, new kinds of jobs. All of this is related to science nowadays, science and technology, but mainly or essentially from science. So this is why this topic of science literacy is extremely important. Continuing on this, there are policy issues that are related to science and technology, not just what I need to know for my daily life, but there are general policies that are extremely important. Genetically modified organisms, should they be banned or not in foods? Nuclear energy, Is this good, not good? In Europe, Germany, after the Fukushima accident about 5 years ago, Germany decided to go no nuclear. Here we're going for nuclear. In France, 60% of the energy is all coming from nuclear reactors. They have 39 reactors, and now there's a whole debate as to are they becoming old, these reactors? Is there a problem? So all of this needs to be understood. Climate change, of course, is probably the biggest issue of our times. And understanding discoveries, even things that don't have to do with policy, but understanding discoveries. What will really have an impact on our lives? So if we don't understand really what's going on in science and technology, then we don't really know where we're going or what's going to happen in our lives. What changes our understanding of the world and the cosmos? So there are discoveries, and I could give talks about this, all kinds of discoveries that change completely our view of how the world functions, what is the cosmos, where are we in the cosmos, etc. So that's part of the science literacy. And then there is the need for developing a culture of science, as I said, in having society adopt and implement in its mode of behavior and its mode of discussion this kind of scientific thinking. Science literacy tests. Now, there have been for several decades now a number of science literacy tests that are given in different places of the world. Very, very few of them, just to tell you, in our part of the world. In fact, I don't know any science literacy test that has been given in any Arab world up to today. There are a couple in the Muslim world. This talk is about the Muslim world. In Malaysia, as you'll see in a moment, in Turkey, a number of years ago, but there are none in the Arab world. But in the West and in a number of other countries, in Asia, China, Japan, etc., there's a number of science literacy tests that have been conducted. Now, are they accurate? What do they mean? What are they made of, these tests, is what I want to explore with you for the next 10-15 minutes. Here's the latest one that can be found in the literature. This is from 2018. This is from the National Science Foundation, and this is sort of the general result. General result, if we compare these countries that have participated, you can see that Malaysia is the only country from the Muslim world. China, Japan, and Russia, Switzerland, USA, Israel, Canada, all of them have participated. So essentially, this is when you average percentages of correct answers by country, this is what you get. Now, the first thing I want to point out, and this is part of science literacy. If you compare, for example, 72% and 71%, there is no difference between these two numbers. When I, as a scientist, look at this, first of all, when I look at this, the first thing I ask myself is, what is the error bar? What is the uncertainty over this value? You can never give in science or in any survey a number without plus or minus. Plus or minus how much? So I went back and looked what are the numbers of people who were surveyed, and from that I inferred that the level of uncertainty is about 2%, it's a little bit less than 2%. Meaning, when you read this, you should always understand this means somewhere between 70 and 74%, perhaps even a wider range. Meaning 72 and 71 is essentially the same. 63, 61, 60, 59 are essentially the same. 53 is maybe slightly different, is about what we call 2 sigma from this, so even this I wouldn't consider really beyond or substantially different from this. Then all of these, except maybe from the 33%, are about the same. So just so you start to see when you're reading numbers like this and results, you don't make too much about, oh, there's a big difference. So if somebody says, oh, so the United States came out fifth among 9 or 10 countries, and I say, you can't say fifth. You can only say maybe in the second tier, maybe. Even in the second tier, it's not so far from the first tier. And it's not so far ahead of the third tier. So this is just to give you an idea. Now, we start to dig deeper into what kind of questions were asked. Now, follow with me because, as I said, there will be a quiz, okay? Question one, I will show you the 10 questions that were asked. We'll go a bit fast. Maybe some of these will show up in the quiz, maybe not, but just pay attention. There is another reason why I'm showing you these questions. You will see a deeper, more important reason than just to quiz you or anything. True or false, the center of the Earth is very hot. I don't know, we'll see. The point is not to show the answers, it's not to give the answers, but to see what kind of questions are asked, and then we will ask ourselves, does it make sense to ask these questions? Are these questions really meaningful? Does it really show that I'm scientifically literate? Is that what you really want from me, to know that the Earth, the center of the Earth, is hot? By the way, the answer is true, of course. It is very hot, very hot. And in fact, if you want to know more, the center of the Earth, temperature of the center of the Earth is about the same as the temperature of the surface of the Sun, about 6,000 degrees, okay, roughly. Now, question two, true or false? The continents have been moving their location for millions of years and will continue to move. Is this true or, see, here's the problem with this question. So in principle, yes, there has been, you know, plate tectonics moving, etc. Then it says, for millions of years. And you say, millions of years? That's not geological age. It should be hundreds of millions of years, if not billions of years. So right there, there's a problem with this question, see? Now, you will see later, which is correct? The Earth goes around the Sun goes around the Earth. You might not, but you will find that there's usually, on average, about 30% of people who answer this one, okay? In our part of the world, there is a growing tendency of people deliberately answering this wrong. Not wrong, according to them, not wrong. They will say, no, there is no evidence that the Earth goes around the Sun. We have had a return of geocentrism, okay? So that we can talk about next week or the week after into the causes and the challenges of what is happening in science literacy. But one of the trends that we have noticed in the last few years, 5 years or so, I can also give a whole talk on this, is the return of geocentrism, okay? And the return of flat earthism also, okay? The Earth is flat. Now there are thousands of people. Last year I had a whole Twitter, you know, raging exchange with a person who is actually a medical doctor, just so you know, was insisting that the Earth is flat, okay, on Twitter. Anyway, so let's proceed. Question four, true or false, all radioactivity is man-made. Now there's a problem with, there's a big problem with this question, because it assumes that you already know what radioactivity is. And then it assumes that you can even think of how radioactivity comes about, and whether human activity and human industry produces radioactivity or not. So there's a whole bunch of information here that is hidden in this true or false. True or false. So as you can see, I'm beginning to criticize this science literacy test. And you will see even more as we proceed. True or false, electrons are smaller than atoms. The moment I read this, and I was teaching modern physics this morning, so this is my stuff, but the moment I read this, I say, what? Why are you asking that? So that's my question. As I read this, now I take off my hat as physics professor, and I look at him as somebody who's interested in science literacy and the culture of science, and I say, really? Why do you want to know? Why do you insist on people knowing whether electrons, what are electrons to begin with? Anyway, we'll see. Some more now. We're just at question six. There are 10 of them, as I said. True or false, lasers work by focusing sound waves. I don't know. Lasers are fundamentally important that I should know about them. I should know how they work. I don't know. Maybe. Of course, the answer, and there's a double problem with this. Lasers don't focus anything. Okay? What they're trying to tell you is that, of course, lasers function with light, not sound waves, electromagnetic waves. But the usage of the word focusing already throws you off. So people who are trying to check whether you are scientifically literate are giving you wrong implicit information in the question to begin with. True or false, the universe began with a huge explosion. Yeah, sort of. I mean, somebody asked me, I said, yeah, you could call it, it's called the Big Bang, right? Well, the Big Bang, is it an explosion? No. The cosmologist will insist there was not an explosion. There was nothing to explode in, right? But anyway, so what they mean is Big Bang. Do you know that there was a Big Bang? Question eight, again, true or false, it is the father's gene that decides whether the baby is a boy or a girl. Now, this is a very interesting question and very significant question because it touches deep into culture and how we think of babies that come out, and if some parents keep having daughters. Our next door neighbor in Algeria, when I was a university student, had this problem. They had four daughters in a row, and the woman was scared to death. I'm serious. That she was going to be divorced, that her husband was going to marry somebody else. Because this woman doesn't give me boys. I have something seriously wrong with this woman, right? And my mother, I remember my late mother, bless her soul, was telling me about this prayer. I said, nothing to do with her. nothing to do with her. Please tell her. I said, are you serious? I said, yes, 100%. On my soul. Go tell her. Go tell her and tell the family. Nothing to do with her. Question 9, true or false, antibiotics. But then you see, this already assumes that you know what genes are. And anyway, true or false, antibiotics kill viruses as well as bacteria. I don't know how much science you need to know to understand this. It is just, do you know? So this is a question like, do you know this or not? It is significant because it plays a vital role in health and in health policies and hospitals and so forth. But it is just, it's not saying do you understand science, it's just saying do you know this or not? It's like trivia. True or false, human beings as we know them today developed from earlier species of animals. So this is evolution. Now you will or will not be surprised that this question was not asked by Malaysia. So you start to see what happened. There were some other questions, by the way, strangely, that were not asked by sometimes Japan, sometimes China. They say, okay, this question was not selected by Japan. They didn't want to ask that question. But this one specifically was not asked by Malaysia. So there we have a problem, because we're already sort of censoring what kind of science information people should have. We don't even want to know whether people know about evolution or not. Forget what they believe. Okay? Now, other such questions given on surveys, so I've gone and reviewed a number of science literacy surveys like this. This comes from this John Miller, who has been the number one expert on science literacy. So these are additional questions. Some of the previous questions are also found in his literacy test, but some of other questions, such as these, were not selected by this NSF international survey, including, for example, which travels faster, light or sound, the earliest humans lived at the same time as the dinosaurs, how long does the Earth take to go around the sun? You would be surprised also that not everybody knows this one here. Another one from the Pew Research Center 2014, which kind of waves are used to make and receive cell phone calls? Radio waves, visible light waves, sound waves, gravity waves. It's radio waves, of course. What does a light year measure? And of course, this is sort of most people think, because it says light year, then it is a time, when of course it is a distance. That is, do you know that light year is really a distance and cosmic distance between stars and galaxies? What is the main way that ocean tides are created? This is where you get into the gravitational pull, and most people, by the way, misunderstand time. I teach astronomy. Remember this? No? Maybe? So no? Maybe? I teach astronomy, and I ask, when I start to explain tides, I ask people the seemingly simple question. I say, how many high tides and how many low tides do we get on a given day? And you know, he said, on a given day. You mean in a given month? No, I said, no, given day. Oh, we get high tides and low tides every day? I said, right there, you're showing me how much you know. And how many? Very, very, very few students, if any, know that we get two high tides and two low tides in 24 hours. Anyway, but that's what you are supposed to have learned in school. Other such questions, now I'll go faster a little bit on this. Now, the reason I'm showing you this, and I'll tell you what my agenda is to show that many of these science literacy tests are really above people's heads. And they're not testing anything valuable. Like, for example, this one here. Which of these pictures best illustrates what happens when light passes through a magnifying glass? Now, the moment you read that question, you're already thinking, what do you mean? Light goes through magnifying glass? So it takes a moment to even figure out what are they talking about. Oh, you mean through a lens? Okay, so if you have a lens and you make light go through it, what happens? And then so you have a lens like this, and it goes like this, it goes like this, and it goes like this. And you're supposed to know that when it is represented like this, this is a converging concave lens, and therefore the light should go like this. Not like this, it doesn't bounce back, it doesn't go straight. And a number of other questions like this. Does water boil at a lower, higher, or same temperature at higher altitudes? The loudness of the sound is determined by what property of the sound wave, frequency, wavelength, velocity, or amplitude? which of these people have developed the polio vaccine? Marie Curie, Isaac Newton, Albert Einstein, Jonas Salk. And most people don't know any of this. But my main question is not, do people know, should they know? It is, what should they know? Really, what should they know? So there are problems with these such surveys. I have hinted at them now already. They often measure people's opinions on given questions, not their knowledge of the science. Yeah, it's like, okay, here's what I think of this. I say, I'm not asking you what you think, I'm asking you. So sometimes the questions are rephrased and it says, according to scientists, this, this, this. And then the moment I read this, according to, I go crazy. And I say, what do you mean according to? It's not like my opinion. In science, there's no my opinion and your opinion, according to me. And believe me, I ask students to write essays at the end of every astronomy course. And I get this according to, because they are used to according to. And they give you a reference and all of this, and they give you maybe even a quote and a citation and everything. As according to? What according to? It's either scientifically established or it is not. It has nothing to do with who says what. Anyway, so there's a problem there. There are often problems with the wordings of questions, and we've encountered a number of them, and sometimes it goes even worse. People often give answers they don't really believe. This is called non-attitude in such survey literature. It's like, I know what they're asking for, I'll give them that. Or just to throw them off, or just to tell them that I disagree with this, then I'll give them a different answer. So you have to be careful in distinguishing what people really say compared to what people really think. They don't measure understanding of the scientific approach, how we know what we know, and how certain of that knowledge we are. I tell my students, look, in the end, every time I tell you anything, ask yourself and ask me if you cannot answer it for yourself, how do we know it? Science is about how we know something, not what we know. Science is not a bunch of facts. Science is a process. It's a method. It is understanding how we reach certain conclusions, and how we reach certain conclusions will determine how certain we are of that, and how we check ourselves. Many scientists have said, science, the greatest value of science is that it is a self-checking process. It is internally checking. It has built in some checking procedures so that we check each other and we keep checking each other. There's peer review, there's repeatability of experiments, and so on and so forth. There's all kinds of things that go like that. None of this is being asked in the science literacy. Nobody, it doesn't show me anything about people understanding how science is really functioning or not. And then there are sampling issues. So I will run in a moment a quiz, but that quiz is obviously meaningless because I only have like 15 people in the room. Plus, you are a self-selected group, or almost well-selected group, because you are interested in these topics, you are obviously highly educated, you come at 7 p.m. on a weekday to listen to a talk. You're not general population, right? You're not general population. And so we have to be careful when we do. It insists on giving you the message. That's fine. All right, so let's try short but hopefully reasonable science literacy test. So I have produced my own science literacy test for the purpose of today only. It's not published, does not exist anywhere. So this is the first time we are being pioneer here. Yes, in being pioneer. So it will take 10 minutes. Okay, there are 10 questions on both sides. Sorry? Oh, we have pens and everything, don't worry. You can't escape, please. So take 10 minutes, just answer. They are anonymous, nobody writes a name, okay? But I do need a little bit of personal information. Sorry, maybe you can. Just write whatever you know, whatever you think. Just write. No, the purpose of this exercise is not really to test you or to know what you know, what you don't know. Your small group anyway is not going to teach us anything. It is really a learning exercise. It's for you to read these questions and say, oh yeah, so that's what I should be thinking, or that's what I should be learning about. So it is a learning exercise, okay? Instead of me just lecturing on the screen, I'm letting you learn on your own. Yeah. Well, the only one I would really grade is Jess's answer. Just kidding. Your name will not be on it. Oh, sorry, this is... Did somebody get a paper that has only one side or?
I put them back.
Make sure you have both sides, all 10 questions, yeah? So if somebody was asking something?
Can we get the papers?
No, you give them back to me. If you want a copy, I'll give you a copy. Yeah, I'll give you a copy, but I need your answers to take back home and have fun.
No, it's just that the pressure from the gravitational push raises the temperature. On the established science. Oh, okay. The other one is getting higher, I mean. Oh, you want it? Intestines are very strong. I'm strong with like a lot of power. This, I think, if I put it correctly, there's only one white pixel, which is the green zooming target.
That's the green, which is.
Oh, in the last one, yeah, in the last
one.
Yeah, correct. In the last one, there's a little bit more. you want three copies of this to take home and retake the test or something, feel free. I'll put them here so you can just tell yourselves. So the finished ones come here. So, well, almost, yes, thank you. Sorry? Yeah, there are some additional ones over there. We're missing one and one, okay. A smile.
Okay.
This is supposed to be just a learning exercise.
Have you seen it?
You're not gonna get a degree out of this. You know these A students?
Are you going to do the same
place
in Arabic next week?
Sorry?
Are you
going to
do the same
place in Arabic? Yeah. You think this is going to be leaked?
Who's in the grammar questions?
Don't post on Facebook or Twitter. Okay, until next week. Until we do this in Arabic next week, then feel free to kick it around. Okay, so I'll just give you the answers very quickly. So the age of the Earth is approximately 5 billion years, 4.5, 4.6. 13.8 is the universe, it's the entire universe. The Milky Way is a little bit less than that, maybe 12 or so. Humans as a species have existed on Earth for roughly, so now if we're talking about modern humans, it's about 100,000 years. Modern humans. Our animals and all animals and plants have a DNA. True or false?
True.
True. All life, anything alive has a DNA. Okay. Is radiation dangerous? So some types of radiation are dangerous. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. All types of radiation are dangerous. No. All radiation can be dangerous if received with high intensity.
Yes.
No.
Oh,
Some radiation, if it is low intensity, doesn't do you any harm. Okay? Anyway, so we're not here to do physics. The sex of a newborn baby, now you all know this. I mentioned it during the presentation. A doctor tells a couple, now this is interesting, this is why I put this in here. Because people need to understand, and this is part of science literacy, need to understand probability, statistics, these kind of things. Not just, do you know how hot the center of the Earth is? But really understand these things. A doctor tells a couple that they have a 25% chance of having a child with an inherited illness. Does this mean that if they have only three children, none will have the illness? No, that's not true. There's always the one in four, 25% chance. If their first child has the illness, the next three will not.
No.
Not true either. Each of the couple's children will have the same risk of suffering the illness.
Yes.
If the first three children are healthy, the fourth will have the illness.
No.
You're all good. Bravo. The age of the Earth can be determined accurately, sorry, typo here, accurately, can only be determined very approximately, is largely unknown. Accurately. The answer is accurately. There is a number of methods by which we determine the age of the Earth. Very accurately. 4.56, whatever, billion years. Very accurate. Science has definitely established that astrology is wrong, and the answer is yes.
No, but that was a creepy question. Astrology is wrong, but moon does exist and exert behavioral effects based on tides, based on...
Absolutely, crime rates go up on one. The basis is statistically demonstrated.
That's next month's talk, okay?
So astrology has been demonstrated, but
yeah.
It also said that the moon planet sun
has affected. Yes. I know what you're saying. And that is incorrect.
But the sun has an effect on people.
Well, if you don't have enough sun, then you don't have vitamin D, your behavior goes down.
Not the sun, that's just light and heat and radiation. So that's different.
And
now, the moon, hold on a second. You said the moon has effects, crime rates go up. Okay. None of that is true. None of that is true. As I said, next month I'll give a talk to this. Happy to come again. I'm ready to be challenged. Bring you all the evidence and everything. Okay? Anyway, let's move on.
See
on genetically modified organisms, GMOs, there is no scientific evidence that they are harmful to humans. Strong scientific evidence that they are harmful to humans. No scientific evidence.
But again, that's a trick question, because genetically modified organisms pose a vast host of possibilities. You can genetically modify a bacteria to be totally new from the bins.
No, but what we mean is genetically modified organisms such as is used in foods and maybe I should rephrase the question.
But also there's other kinds of harm that they cause.
Yeah.
Sorry?
So there's other kinds of harm that they cause. So the fact that they use a certain area to make the land unusable in 20 years' time, and the secondary effect.
So that's true always for them, almost for everything. There's always some secondary effects that you're doing. So we're not talking about that thing itself.
It's
the debate
between
the other. The greenhouse effect. So I'm showing you my colors, okay? Just so you can. The scientist is speaking. According to me, no? The greenhouse effect is the Earth's atmosphere. In the Earth's atmosphere, is caused by the CO2 emitted by human activity, factories, cars. It's caused by CO2 and other greenhouse gases produced by human activity. It's caused by various greenhouse gases produced by human activity and or naturally existing, causes the temperature in the Earth's atmosphere to increase. The last one. Correct. Last one. All right, let's continue. If you thought this quiz was hard, wait until you see the next one. Okay? But you are a very good team helping and participating in my interest. All right, so. Culture of science now is different. So now second part, hopefully shorter or not so long. Culture of science is rather different. What is it? I like this definition given by my good friend Munif Zohri, who is the executive director of the Academy of Science of the Islamic World, believe it or not. He's based in Amman, Jordan. And in a project that we have been doing together with a number of other people on the culture of science in the Muslim world, he proposed this definition, which I thought was very, very interesting. A culture of science is the appreciation, adoption, and application of scientific principles at the individual and society levels. That's culture of science, not scientific or science literacy, what you know, what you don't know. It's how much the scientific principles have been adopted and implemented at the individual and societal levels. To be scientifically minded, meaning to use valid sources, to use inferential reasoning, evidence-based argumentation to draw conclusions about the given issue. In other words, to think like a scientist. If you have a culture of science, it means you really think as the scientists do, or you adopt this methodology. To have a general awareness of how science and technology shape our material, intellectual, and cultural environments, also part of the culture of science. To distinguish proper science from pseudoscience. Pseudoscience is what comes about as pretending to be science and is actually not science, including astrology, including all the numerology stuff, including what else? The health or medical procedures that have spread out recently. You know, sorry? Say? Well, chiropractic, it depends, because they could have some physical effect or not. Maybe it is placebo. I am a big fan of the placebo effect. I'm a big fan. I think the placebo is an extremely important effect. Anyway, there's a number of, you know, those copper bands that people wear, the bloodletting stuff that people have been doing. You've seen those, even the swimmers, what's his name, Michael Phelps, showed up one day with all kinds of stuff, and I said, what have you done? And he said, oh, it's really good, it helps. I'm like, oh my God, you just killed half of science. Anyway, pseudoscience, that's a whole another ballgame. Ability to critically assess scientific information, understand probabilistic arguments, as I tried to ask you with that doctor question. So all of this is the culture of science. Understand statistical information properly. I also tried to show you when I showed you the results of the science literacy, how you should think of results that are different or not different, and so on and so forth. Why the culture of science is important in principle? Promoting the culture of science, not technology, promoting the culture of science, and I will insist on this in a moment. We, in our part of the world, in the Arab Muslim world, love technology very much. We promote technology so much. We are the first, how do you call them, the first adopters or something, there is the expression, early adopters of all technologies. We love that stuff. Sometimes people show me stuff and I say, what is this? Oh, you don't know about this? I say, I haven't seen it. There's a huge difference between adopting technology, loving technology, using technology, and adopting science. Can develop a refined way of thinking and behaving in life more widely. This is why cultural science is significant. Because it really sort of trains your brain, trains your mind in thinking in the right way, in knowing how to compare things, how to sift through things, how to filter nonsensical information. So this is just a few cartoons. If you explain this part more, etc., we'll skip all this. Why is the culture of science important? Still, people who have practiced science universally agree. The scientists, is again, that according to the scientists. The scientists, or people who practice science, universally agree that both science literacy, what we discussed before, and culture of science should be maximally spread through society. Why? Here's a quote from a very famous person, you will see who in a minute, who said, if science, like art, now we're not just all crazy about science and forget everything else, okay? Science, like art, is to perform its mission totally and fully. Its achievements must enter not only superficially, but with their inner meaning into the consciousness of people. Culture of science. Who said this? Albert Einstein, 1939, address to the World's Fair. He said, it needs to really get into our consciousness. Like art, if it is going to really impress upon us or have an impact. Otherwise, if we just know a few things, then that's not an achievement of science. Science literacy in the Muslim world, there also science literacy in the Islamic world, largely unknown. I mentioned earlier that I don't know any results in the entire Arab world. You saw earlier that there are some results from Malaysia. I mentioned that there are some results from Turkey, from 10 years ago or something. But that's pretty much all that I have seen, and I have, believe me, I have searched the literature. So for example, just to show you that I have really searched the literature. When you search the literature, here's what you find. So you find, for example, a paper, the representation of scientific literacy in Egyptian science textbooks. Now, so this is a researcher who went, this is in 2010, published a paper having dug through the science textbooks to try to see to what extent do these science textbooks carry science literacy. That's one paper, but this is already 8 years ago, and only looking through the books, not asking people or checking with people. Here's another one from Kuwait, 2015. The sociocultural context of science curriculum reform in the state of Kuwait. The sociocultural context. Here's another one, this is from Turkey. When was this? 2009. Determination of science literacy levels of the classroom teachers. So now we're looking at what do teachers really know. Here's another one from Jordan, 2013. Science teaching and level of the scientific literacy of the primary school teacher in Jordan. Here's another one from UAE, 2005-2006. Coverage of scientific literacy in UAE science textbooks. Again, this is not a survey. This is just looking in the textbooks and what do the textbooks seem to carry and convey. And the last one I found is, where is this? Lebanese biology national exams, 2014. That's pretty much it. And I've searched really through the academic literature. Yeah? So there's some work to be done. Culture of science in the Muslim world readily accepts and consumes high technology from cell phones and HDTV to high-tech instruments of medical diagnosis. None of this is wrong. I'm not saying this is wrong to be high consumers of high technology. I'm just saying that the Muslim world largely ignores basic science, meaning non-applied. This is what I call ultra-utilitarianism. There's a utilitarian view of science. Like, science, is this beneficial? You will not, maybe you will not be surprised, but you cannot imagine how many times I get asked, whenever I convey some discovery, and every other day almost, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but every week or so there is something in my field, at least in astronomy, astrophysics, and I convey it on Twitter or Facebook, I almost always get this question, what good is that for us? People are always asking, what good is that? Well, I say, don't you want to know? Aren't you a better person that you know this now? No, I mean in my life, how does this help me? So there's this utilitarian approach to science. In intellectual debate, science seldom emerges as a subject of deliberation. I forget who this quote is from, but this is a significant quote because it insists that even in intellectual debates in our part of the world, science is not part of the discussions. It's not included or it's not come up in the discussions of various intellectual debates. Let's try short now. Say, not again. Quick now, 5 minutes. Now is this science culture? This one has. So this is again 2 pages. There are 7 questions. Shouldn't take more than 5 minutes. Again, the idea is not to test you. The idea is to show you through the questions, that these questions that relate to culture of science are different from questions that relate to science literacy. In the previous one, I was trying to see how you understand science, but now it is to what extent you promote the culture of science. Yeah, the last question, if you disagree, I'll try.
Well, it's
okay. Oh, disagree? Okay. We'll have a discussion sometime.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Thanks very much. All right. So, on this, as you have noticed, there are no right and wrong answers. Right? It's not like, oh, the answer is. I can't give you the answer is. But as you may have realized, it is really trying to test to what extent you really promote science in your mind at least. Yeah? So how often do you read or watch news stories about science in newspapers and internet, etc.? The more often you do this, the more you have this culture of science. That's the idea. Yeah? Sorry? Sure, yeah, of course, yes, absolutely. Science doesn't just mean, physics and astronomy, etc. It means, as in the next question, it says, zoos, animals, the natural world, everything is part of the study of nature, all of it is part of science. Yeah. So when was the last time you visited the science museum, planetarium, aquarium, or zoo? Believe it or not, this is a significant question that is asked around the world. people want to know. So how often do parents, children, families go and check out these places? Or are we just going to the mall? Or are we just going to watch movies? I have nothing against movies, on the contrary, but...
Sci-fi.
Among others. All waiting for the first planet to come out. The development of science and technology has been extremely beneficial to human civilization, hopefully. Science brings more to humans than just technology. See, this is where we start to sort of test people. It will make people think by asking such a question. They think, does it bring more or does it bring more than technology? If they start to think, yes, it does bring me more than just technology, then they have acquired some culture of science. If they say, I don't see what science brings, then okay, it brings technology, but I don't see. Science should be restrained because it often leads to bigger problems than what it tries to solve. Sorry, this is again the biased scientist speaking, but science doesn't bring any problems. Science brings knowledge, and then how you apply that knowledge is a different matter. And it's subject to all kinds of things. Scientists are human beings, but whatever they discover, they discover. Government should fund scientific research regardless of its immediate and practical benefit to society. I think this is the most significant question. If people say, no, I don't think, if there is no practical immediate benefit to society, why should we be wasting money on this? And again, you will not imagine how many times people have asked me, why are you wasting billions of dollars in space? Maybe that's what just means, but I don't know. We'll see. And I've written, actually, there is an article of mine, why are you wasting so much money in space? And the article exists both in English and in Arabic. If you search the web, you find it. Why are you wasting money in space? Trying to sort of rebut. That's why I ask the questions provocatively. But then I answer why we are wasting money in space. No? So that's not like that. Government should strongly support space exploration. Now you have my views. Now, let's continue. We're almost done. Challenges in cultural science. Now, what are the challenges for the spread of this cultural science that I have been saying is important? There's lack of infrastructure. In some places, there are no science museums. It's like, you ask me to go visit science museum? Doesn't exist. In some places, people cannot watch science documentaries. In some places, they cannot go out and use even telescope or binoculars. You will not believe that in some countries, selling telescopes is forbidden, is outlawed, because it is security issue with telescopes. So there is lack of infrastructure in some places, instruments, labs, observatories, etc. There's sometimes an infertile environment. It's difficult to spread sometimes scientific, science culture, the culture of science. There's sort of a critical thinking is not developed enough in some places, in some cultures, in some education system. There are in some places no academic freedom. People are not allowed or are not protected if they write or publish or give lectures on sensitive topics. Yeah. There's lack of promotion of science, I mentioned this, museum, festival, etc. Cultural attitudes. There are some cultural attitudes. I'll talk about this a little bit more in a minute. There is censorship by social powers and authorities. Maybe not here, but in many places. The social powers and authorities can be political, can be religious, can be administrative. Even universities sometimes do not allow professors to speak directly to the media. You are not allowed. If some media contacts me and wants an interview, I have to refer them to our communications department. Huh? Yeah, it's not in many places. It's like you cannot just go out and spread your knowledge. You can't. Because there's some administrative, I'm not even talking about the political and religious constraints and restraints. There are science wars of two cultures. This is a long, long debate, a long story. Skip it if you want to ask it, but we can discuss that. There's self-censorship. People censor themselves. They say, I don't want to talk about that. What do you think of evolution? You're a biologist. Come, we need to have a panel and we need to discuss evolution. No. Leave me alone. I don't want to even mention that. I don't want to write about that. I don't want to be interviewed about that. You're a biology professor. No, leave me alone. Social media have leveled the field. Leveled the field meaning gave equal footing and equal voice to everybody, those who know and those who don't know. So then it becomes like, how many followers do I have compared to somebody else who has 3 million followers and then says something that has scientific content and is absolutely wrong. That's what social media does. It doesn't differentiate between knowledge carriers. And then there are important Western standards and idols. There are so many people who just worship some science communicators from out there. I'm not going to mention any names since I'm being recalled. And if you talk to people and they say, oh, I love science, I watch that person, you know, every week. I say, that person has his own viewpoint and approach. And why don't you take people from your own community? I mean, we have enough scientists and science communicators. We have some great science communicators in this part of the world, believe it or not. But that's what we get. So social media have done this. Public disinterest due to a culture of entertainment. Now, unless it is flashy, and unless it is exciting, and you know, bright topics, people are not going to listen or watch. Now, I have a YouTube channel, as you know. I have a quasi-weekly series, and I can see. In fact, just 2 weeks ago, when we did the 100th episode and interviewed Mr. Saeed and others, and I went there and I said, folks, I want to tell you something. I'm sorry to come out on the 100th anniversary of my show and to have to chide you on this, but don't just watch the flashy episodes, please. Watch the more interesting and meaty ones, even if it's 15, 20 minutes. You will learn something, I guarantee. Don't just go for the exciting and controversial topics. Don't do that. Anyway, but this is the culture of entertainment that we have developed. Unless it is, you know, sort of exciting and controversial, people will not. So conclusions, we need to explore new ways of spreading science literacy and the culture of science. We need role models, we need new forms of engagement, we need mutual understanding with religion. We need better assessment tools for science literacy and culture of science, as I tried to show through these little tests here. And I showed you some examples from what is being used nowadays and the flaws that exist in them. We need to conduct surveys of science literacy and culture of science in the Muslim world. As I said, there's almost nothing, not though. The Dubai Future Academy or Foundation can be a pioneer in this regard. Hint, hint. Seriously, I mean, we can really develop new types of surveys, show that we are improving on the current standards, international standards. So on the one hand, we improve on what exists, and on the other, we explore the region and our part of the world as to what people know and therefore how to really improve on their science culture and science interests. Thank you very much. I think I have taken way too long, but thank you for your patience.
Any questions?
Very good. So there are different science literacy tests, and some of them are given to high school students, for example, and then the results are shown clearly that this is for high school students. Sometimes they are given for teachers specifically, just to make sure or try to see what teachers know, what they don't know. Other than that, usually when there is no specification of category or age, it means adult population. Anybody above 18 or something. That's why, by the way, I asked for your age, because I wasn't sure if maybe there would be some younger children, etc. But usually people always ask for the age, just to see. And people also check the gender, so that wasn't just me being gender biased or anything. But very often people try to compare and see, is there any difference and why? Even if there is a difference between results by gender, it doesn't mean there's anything wrong. It just means maybe the education system is built in that way, or maybe the communication is not being properly constructed. But these are standard questions that that people ask: age, gender, etc. Yeah. Yes.
Since the topic is culture of science and religion,
question first. Like, what are your thoughts on the egocentric pivot, which is like things cannot exist outside of your consciousness? And secondly, if that's the case, can science exist outside of your consciousness? So if science exists outside of our consciousness, because we're not naturally able to comprehend it, or it's almost like the question related to this area is like, should we pursue this research if there's no direct
that's the thing, you don't know what the question is. Yeah. You're not asking the right question. Right. So, this is known in philosophy of science as the problem of realism. So, is what we are describing real, meaning outside of us, independent of us? If I do an experiment and I die in the middle of the experiment, somebody comes and performs the experiment, does it in a completely different setting, different place, do they get the same results? Because it really depends on what's out there compared to what's in here. There's most scientists, almost all scientists, adopt this realism philosophy of science, that we are really looking at something that is independent of us. There is something, there are some sort of nuances. People discuss critical realism. Like, yeah, you have to be careful, but we are looking at it in a specific way because of the biases in our way of thinking and what has come before us, and that's why from time to time there's a big paradigm shift, or there's a big revolution, so you have to always be careful. That's why it took thousands of years for us to get rid of geocentrism, coming back now. So for the most part, people, including myself, believe in this realism, meaning that what we are really observing and studying is independent of us. But the way we study it or what we see, you know, is sometimes in the eye of the beholder, so you have to be careful. And that's why I say it's always a self-checking mechanism. And that's why I always insist on one thing that is very important in science, in my view. And that is, science is a collective endeavor. And that's why there is no according to. It's a collective endeavor. So, suppose I am completely deluded, completely wrong. The way I look at the world is just so completely ridiculously crazy. Okay, stupid. But I'm completely convinced that I am right. And I build a theory or a model or something. But there will be others who will check. And I have to make predictions. There's something called falsifiability. I have to make predictions, somebody has to test and check. And so there's always this mutual checking and mutual, you know, shooting down of each other, that in the end, what survives is only that what is independent of me and the other person.
But then again, that's collective consciousness.
So, yeah, maybe. So if we are all part of the same sort of collective mind and collective thinking, but if we adopt that point of view, then we can't make progress. I mean, we don't know in the end, we really don't know, right? We don't know. But we can only make progress if we believe that we know, we have to believe that what you're doing is correct.
That's
or
the best
that.
Answer.
Huh?
That's the best answer.
Yeah, so if you keep thinking, yeah, maybe this is all wrong, maybe, yeah, you know, people keep asking, so are we in the Matrix? You remember that Matrix movie? Are we in the Matrix? Aren't we all in a sort of a simulation? Somebody playing a simulation? And I say, so first of all, we can't tell. People say, oh, you could notice some glitches. You keep looking for glitches. So I spend my life looking for glitches just to see if there is an error in the program, in the big program from the big guy who is up there programmed all of us. I can't do that. I mean, it doesn't make sense for me to keep looking for glitches. So I have to believe that no, I am real, and this world is real, and my study can reach real conclusions. Otherwise, you can't be a scientist. Somebody said, I don't remember, maybe Einstein. Somebody said the power of science is that it leads you to actual results that are true. Not I have reached this conclusion after 50 years of thinking. No. You have reached a result that you die, maybe you never even existed, that result will remain true. So that's the core assumption in when we do science. If we don't assume that, we really can't do science. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes?
You mentioned something about
the
research about pollution.
Yeah. No, not research. I wrote an article. I mean, there is plenty of research. And I actually quoted in the article. Just look it up. Say, Nidhal Guessoum, air pollution, Arab world, Gulf, something, Google, Arab news, you find it. This is from 2-3 weeks ago. So I went back and found some research. Actually, there is a researcher from the American University in Beirut who published a number of papers, some of which I downloaded and went and read, etc., which give you data about air pollution and CO2 and other pollutants in various countries. Yeah, I think so. Yeah. UAE is part of the data tables that we have here. Look it up. There's actually the, and I mentioned all of that in the article. Interestingly, what was good about his data and paper is that he had results from about 10 years ago, 7 years ago, and some results from maybe 2-3 years ago. So you could see in 5 years, after 5 years, how much progress there has been. And I forget now, but there were, in his table, there were 4 countries from the Gulf. One of them is the UAE. And the UAE and another country, I think it was Bahrain, if I'm not mistaken, were the ones that made significant progress, like 20% improvement or something. Still bad. Still way bad compared to the rest of the world. But significant progress in the last 5 years. And then there are 2 other countries, which I will not mention, have done even worse. But all of this is in the article, and it's not me saying this, I'm just quoting research data.
Okay. Do you think that there is a polarized effect happening today when it comes to people who are, you know, science enthusiasts or into science, who actually, for lack of a term, are all for science, and then those who are, as you mentioned, deliberately,
yes,
are against it? For various reasons. Do you see that happening? If so, what are either the impact, what can we do about it,
yes,
can something be done?
That's a very, very good question. So the short answer is yes, there is this growing polarization. And there are these 2 groups that are, you know, heads on. I have been part of a number of projects in the Arab Muslim world and elsewhere, trying to sort of build bridges or mutual understanding between at least the religious group or the conservative group and more science-oriented, who are not necessarily non-religious or anti-religious, but more science-strong and science-promoters. But very often, including in the Arab world, you tend to find those who are promoting science to be sort of more liberal, anti-conservative, anti-even religion, and vice versa. And I try to show that it doesn't have to be that way, that it can be all harmonious as long as there is some tolerance, there is some mutual understanding, there's some minima that we cannot negotiate over. Nobody's going to come to me and say, okay, let's just to be friends, just tell them that, you know, evolution is just a theory and it's not really true. I say, sorry, I cannot say that. That's non-negotiable, because that's scientifically established. Whatever is established, scientifically established, you have to accept. Now, what I can definitely say, and I always say, that this acceptance of evolution does not rule out religion, does not shoot down religion. But I will not compromise and say, oh, I'll drop down some of my science information just so we can be friends. We cannot do that. But we can find some common terms of understanding. And we should have, by the way, it is amazing how much there is, how much activity there is on common understanding of scientific knowledge, non-scientific knowledge, etc., outside of the Arab world. Outside of the Arab world. And how little in the Arab world, where we suffer the most, and we need most this common understanding and common bridge building, there is much less, much, much less. So I think we can promote this by organizing panel discussions, by having lectures like this, which this was not specifically on this point, but some other such lecture that can be put online, discussion with schools, with teachers, workshops for teachers, etc. I didn't show you my latest book, I'm going to copy, but I don't want to appear to be promoting. But that's what I'm trying to do. Yeah. But I think there is a lot more that can be done and should be done, yes. But because there is this, as you pointed out, this polarization, and it is appearing again. And like I said, I mean, you see it, especially on social media. Those of us who are active on social media, you see this very, very clearly. It's like, you get attacked. You say, oh yeah, you believe NASA. Yeah, of course, you worked for NASA, so what do we expect from you? Of course you believe the NASA stuff. I said, it's not NASA, this is science. You know how many space agencies there are out there? Why do you think NASA? NASA, I have said, half jokingly, has become a four-letter word. NASA, that word. I said, okay, forget NASA, use ESA, European Space Agency, 3 months, okay, you're safe. But that's what people have sort of polarized and look at the other. This science comes from the West. It is this discourse and narrative that comes from NASA and the followers of NASA, and this gets propagated. But there's a lot that needs to be done, definitely. All right. All right, thank you all.
Thank you.